بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، My dear brothers and sisters, it is a great honor and privilege for me to be with you this evening and to talk about a very important subject of today that is faced by the Muslim Ummah throughout the world. I was asked to talk about the Islamic finance. Islamic finance is the phrase that is very oftenly used and heard about by the Muslim Ummah throughout the world. And the subject is so vast and wide that it can hardly be summarized in 1 hour or a short time. But I will try my best, inshallah, to explain the basic concept of Islamic finance. Why Islamic finance is necessary for us? This is the first question. First question is that what is the importance of Islamic finance? This importance has two aspects. It is firstly important for the Muslims, only. And the other aspect is that it is very important for the sake of humanity at large. I'll speak about these two aspects. Firstly, why is it necessary for Muslims? And secondly, why it is necessary for the entire world, for the humanity at large? So, to begin with, when we speak of Islamic finance, it is important for the Muslims because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we recite the kalima of La ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is not something, the words of magic or sorcery. It is a contact that we make with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we say La ilaha illallah, there is no God but Allah. We say that the only being that is worthy of worship, worthy of being obeyed, is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we have a pledge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that whatever your messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has brought to us, we will follow it in letter and spirit. This is the contact we have entered into while we recited the kalima of La ilaha illallah. So, being a Muslim, we are duty bound to follow each and every command given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or His messenger Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And our religion, our deen, that is Islam, is not restricted only to ways of worship or some rituals. Unlike other religions, they are restricted mainly to some rituals, some ways of worship, and some instructions about some ethics or so on. But Islam is a complete code of life, not only for worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also to run our lives in accordance with the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be it economy, be it politics, be any sphere of our lives. It must be complying with the dictates of the Holy Quran and Sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Islam has its own idea of our economy. Economy is the main issue of today. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us some instructions about our economy. We have experienced, firstly, feudalism, then capitalism, then socialism and communism. But none of these systems have solved the problems of humanity. When socialism was failed, then the capitalist world, you know, rejoiced that we have won and we have defeated socialism and communism. But they do not see that even after the fall of communism, there is no equity between haves and have-nots. So therefore, none of these systems has built or was successful to solve the problems of humanity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us some instructions on the basis of which we can solve these problems. One of the very important command or injunction given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the prohibition of riba, that is interest. So this was so important that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used some words about riba that have not been used for any sinful act, including zina, including consuming alcohol or something like that. He said that if you do not leave the practice of riba, then you will be waging war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. These words were not said by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to theft, to dacoity, to adultery, to consuming alcohol, but has used it against war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So being a Muslim, without going into the details of the raison d'etre of this command, we are duty bound to follow it, that we should abandon the practice of riba totally, because we are Muslims. And when a person recites the kalima of la ilaha illallah, he is duty bound to obey the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it seems to him complies to his reason or not. So ma kana lil mu'minin bala mu'minatin idha qala Allahu wa rasuluhu amran an yakuna lahumul khiyaratu fi amrihim. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam decides for something for the mu'min, then there is no choice for the mu'min to accept that, to obey it. So this is what Islam means. Islam in Arabic means submission. Submission to Allah. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And when Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, you know, was ordered to sacrifice his own son Ismail alayhi salam, and he made his son lie on the earth and started to slaughtering him, then at that point Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ. فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا, that both of them submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although the command was such that there is no logic behind it to kill a person without any crime, without any offense, to kill a minor boy that is not even allowed in the state of war. Rasulullah sallallahu Muslim army not to kill a child, But his child was ordered to be killed. And who was the child? His own son. There was no logic at all behind this command. But Ibrahim السلام, obeyed and submitted himself. And when he asked Ismail السلام, إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى, then Ismail السلام did not ask, why? What is the logic behind this? What is the reason for which I am being killed? No, just said, يَا أَبَتِ فَعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ, you please go on obeying the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the Islam in its true sense, that when a command comes to a Muslim, then he can sacrifice all his wealth, all his emotions for obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the problem is that when we say that riba is haram or interest is not allowed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then some people ask, why interest is haram? What is the logic behind it? What is the reason for prohibition of this interest? So they come forward to say that this command must be based on some logic, and unless we understand that logic, we cannot obey it. This is not Islam. Then this is following one's own reason, not following Allah or Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, this is very important for Muslims that they avoid interest-based transactions. So this is because this is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is important for the Muslims because it is a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, Islamic finance presents a solution for avoiding interest and basing our own transactions on something that is allowed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ahallallahu al-bay'a wa harrama riba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed sale, but he has prohibited riba, that is interest. So Islamic finance is important for the Muslim for this reason, that they have to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they must avoid interest. Then there should be some alternate. Alternate is provided by Islamic finance. This is the reason for which it is important for Muslims. Now I come to the second question that I raised in the beginning, that why Islamic finance is important for the entire world, for humanity at large. This is a question that must be fully understood by us. Although riba is haram, therefore we have to avoid it. But the economic system that is prevailing today is based on interest. And although the prohibition of riba is not restricted to Holy Quran only, this was prohibited by the Bible. This was prohibited in clear terms by the Bible. There are many verses in the Bible that say that one cannot indulge in the practice of riba. But when came the Industrial Revolution, then they wanted to base their economy on the basis of interest. So the verses of Bible came as an obstruction before them. So the problem was that they were believing in Bible, they were believing in the verses of Bible, and on the other hand, they wanted to to eradicate the economy according based on interest. So now the first person who came forward to solve this problem, according to my limited knowledge, was John Calvin. John Calvin, one of the famous leaders of Protestant, he was a companion of Martin Luther, who was the founder of Protestant sect. So he came forward and said, no, the riba that was prohibited by Bible was something else. And the riba that we are practicing today in our industry, in our banks or financial institutions, is totally different from what was prohibited in the Bible. Because in previous days, the borrower were poor people. They used to borrow money for their individual needs. For example, they are facing hunger and their family needs bread, but they did not have it. So they asked someone to borrow, to lend them some money. So if a person demands something over and above the principal, then it was a zulm. It was something wrong, because you are dealing with poor people and you are demanding something more than you are lending them. But today, we in the banking system, the borrowers are poor, not poor people. They are wealthy people. They have industries. They are traders. And then when they borrow money from the banks, then they use it for their own benefit, for their own profit. So if something is charged over and above the principal, it should not be taken as zulm. So therefore, he drew the line between interest and usury and said it was usury that was prohibited. But this interest is something modern, and therefore the prohibition doesn't apply to it. This was firstly, according to my knowledge, firstly this idea was presented by John Calvin. And then when interest became the practice of the day, then many people followed suit and they claimed that there was a big difference between usury and interest. Even from the Muslims, there was voices to say that this is not that interest. But my father, Hazrat Maulana Mufti Ahmad Shafi Sahab Rahmatullah Alayh, used to tell a joke about this. He said that one Indian musician, traveled for Hajj, and when he was traveling from Makkah to Medina, he stayed at a place, at a small town, and in those days it was necessary that one sleeps in these caravanserais between Makkah and Medina. So he, after having dinner, he saw that there was an Arab musician, and he started playing music and started singing. But his song or his music was so awkward that he could not resist to say that, may Allah bless our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has heard the music of Arabs, this awkward music of Arabs, therefore he prohibited it. Had he heard my music and my song, he did not prohibit songs. So this kind of argument is say analytic, you know, is about that, the argument of that musician, that it was remote. Now, the basic question is whether a transaction itself is valid or not. If the transaction is valid in sale, for example, if you sell bread to a person, do you differentiate between the purchaser who is wealthy or a poor?
No.
You are allowed to, you know, charge a profit from both. And what is the standard to say that this is poor and this is wealthy? So therefore, this was totally wrong. And this argument was discussed in detail by the Muslim Ummah in their conferences, in their meetings, in their seminars, and it was totally rejected by all the Ummah. And then lastly, it was presented before Islamic Fiqh Academy in Jeddah, of which I happened to be vice chairman at that time. Then all the scholars of earth, they with consensus decided that this argument is false, and anything charged over and above the principle, it is haram, it is riba. Now I would come to the question, why is it necessary to avoid riba? Because once this hurdle was crossed by John Calvin, then all the transactions of the world financing was based on interest. In the beginning, it was just interest. And then came another thing that was another species, you know, a strange species that is called the creation of banks. Banks create money. And the creation of money, they were so, you know, happy to say that our money supply is, you know, has increased because of these banks. But now this fractional reserve system, that is called it, it came to an extent that the money in supply is much less, is much more than the real money found in the banking system. Probably you will be astonished to hear that now, in our days, the actual money, that is debt-ridden money, that is currency, paper currency, is only 3% of the total money supply of the world. Whatever is 97% is nothing but digits fed in computers, have no reality at all. And because of that, the economy turned into a bubble. Rather, I say that it is turned into a balloon. So firstly, paper currency came in. Then came the financial papers, and then came derivatives. There are derivatives in the form of futures, swaps, and options, etc. And the value of these derivatives is so large, huge, that an economist has mentioned that if you take the total value of derivatives in form of dollars and put the dollars one on the top of the other, then they may rotate around the sun 38 times. And what is their money? This, nothing at all, just bubble, just balloon. So therefore, I wrote before in 2004 that this bubble or this balloon will be burst, we can be burst, can burst at any time. And it really actually burst in 2008. The world faced, the whole world faced the financial crisis, and was the all the banks were failed, all the trade were, you know, stocks, you know, faced steep fall. So this is, if you analyze the reasons behind this crisis, the main reason is interest. And interest and sale of debts, and to be out of the real economy. Now we are living in a state of economy in which we don't have any real economy, just figures, just numbers fed in computers. So, and now again they were facing the it is anticipated that the crisis more severe is coming now within a couple of years. So this is, you know, the whole economy is captured by some few people in the world. So all this situation has arisen because of interest. Had there not been interest, then there were no derivatives, no sale of debts, no something that makes the economy a bubble or a balloon. So therefore, humanity now needs a new system that takes care of real economy. And that is the basic difference between sale and riba. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ahallallahu al-bay'a wa harrama al-riba," it means that if you transact money against money, then it must be equal from both sides. You cannot charge anything over and above the principle, because it is a transaction of money against money. But if there is a transaction, money against a commodity, this is sale and this is allowed. And it makes a big difference when you are transacting, you know, money against money, and when you are transacting money against commodity. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. أَحَلَّ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرِّمَ الرِّبَى. لِمَاذَا? Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ. And if you transact as sale, then you are creating a real economy, real assets. But when you are transacting money for money, then in that case you are not creating any asset. This is not real economy. This is just, you know, money against money. So now Islamic finance came and said that now we will base our economy on the real assets, not on in money only. Money is nothing. Money is nothing more than a medium of exchange. It is not a commodity. It should not be traded in. It was created for the purpose of serving as a medium of exchange. Nothing more or less. But the interest system made money an object of sale. And this created a facade in the earth. So now Islamic finance, alhamdulillah, came, and now it is going to, you know, increase throughout the world, alhamdulillah. And it was a time when we spoke about the prohibition of interest, and that the financial institutions should work on the basis, or not on the basis of interest and interest-free transactions. The people used to say it is a utopian idea. It is not practicable. It is just, you know, an imagination, and it cannot be practiced in the actual world. But now, alhamdulillah, since 1970, gradually Islamic institutes came forward and they based their system on the sale, not on riba. So alhamdulillah, now the rate of growth of Islamic finance is more than the growth of conventional finance. Yani, the growth of Islamic financial institutes is more than 15%, while the rate of growth of conventional finance is much less than that. So alhamdulillah, in around 90 countries, Islamic finance is being practiced. And not only in Muslim countries, but also in non-Muslim countries. The basic problem in Western countries for the Muslims is to acquire their homes. Now, alhamdulillah, we have found out how we solve the problem by institutions finance the people, finance the homes on the basis of Islamic principles. And even in US, alhamdulillah, now more than a dozen states, there are Islamic financial institutions who are giving home financing on the basis of Islamic principles, that is sale or lease or something like that. So alhamdulillah, the movement of Islamic finance is going forward, and I hope that it will attract. Now, when the economist analyze the ways and methods adopted by Islamic finance, they admit that this is much more closer to the real economy, and it will in future the most equitable system that can be imagined today. The subject is very wide, but in short, alhamdulillah, I had discussions, I had debates on the subject in different countries by Muslims and non-Muslims both, and alhamdulillah, it was admitted that this is the system that converts the present system into a real economy. So this is the gist of the meaning of Islamic finance. And I think, inshallah, if you in this country, you try to establish, starting from home financing on the basic Islamic principles, inshallah, it will be much beneficial for Muslims, not only for Muslims, but also for non-Muslims, inshallah. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.